Welcome to a new podcast. We are here in the studio with Georgiana, my wife, and with Marjorie Cole. Welcome, Marjorie.
Thank you. Yes.
We are continuing today the series about the war on children. And today we're going to discuss about the virtual world and a generation that lives online. How did this generation of kids and teenagers come to stay so much online and prefer to play games, to be online, to be in something that's not real, than to be involved in something real?
Well, I think this preparation for what we see now, the children, the teenagers, how they're kind of in this virtual world, began way back in the 60s and 70s when we started to program people through television, through movies, through soap operas, through getting them stepping into that TV, movies, stories, and live in that world, you know, whether it was for 2 hours or 30 minutes, whatever, to get in there, to begin to be comfortable in that imagination, in that pretending. And as the decades have gone forward, the enemy has really pushed technology. He's really pushed for this to be his end game, to bring these true creations of God, sons and daughters, into a virtual world where they have made an agreement through stepping into the world, through playing the games, through seeking out those things, to release or give their power, their authority over to the one who they listen to, and they're stepping into the through the doorway into this technical world, and there are many supposed benefits to them for doing this. But I really believe the preparation has been ongoing for years, and we just kind of, when your child is born nowadays, we almost immediately we set them in front of a. It used to be the television was the babysitter, but now it's the screen, it's the iPhone, the parents' phone, the iPad, whatever it is, all these things, they just give it to the child to entertain the child, and it's works super well. The children are absolutely behaved, quiet for the most part. They don't bug the parent. They'll stay in this place, sit in the backseat of the car on a 9-hour car trip, and they'll probably make no trouble at all because they're just so busy playing the games, whatever they are. And it's just, it's almost demonically intriguing how that they can stay so focused, sit so still for so long in this kind of a technical world. It's crazy. But I believe it's there's a design, there's a deliberate plot that Satan has set up with this to pull these kids away from their world, away from their life, away from Jesus, away from the truth, into a world that really doesn't exist, but it does exist in their imagination, in a virtual world.
Yeah, but what effect can have being on this virtual world in the case of a child or a teenager or just a young person, like spending hours and hours every day? What happens with this person, like, yeah, on every level, with psychology part, spiritual part, the physical part? What's happening with this person?
Well, in a child, in the development of a child, they develop and learn how to speak, they learn how to communicate, they learn how to do relationships, they learn how to hold their table manners, hold their fork, whatever. They learn all of these things by watching and by other people doing and speaking and connecting with them, talking with them, mom and dad sitting down reading a book with them, a story. They're learning through the doing. They're learning through being exposed to these things. And when they're not exposed to the real world that we live in with the realities of that world, when they're sucked away from that and put into an artificial world, a world of simulations and, you know, fantasies and fables and storybook, you know, even in the way, way, way back, we have had, you know, bedtime stories and Mother Goose fables and things like that. It's always to allow the child to go into another place, Jack and the Beanstalk, you know, an imagination where, you know, we're kind of prone to want to explore those areas that are unknown or are forbidden. And so that becomes an intriguing thing. But nowadays, when the child has no real meaningful exposure to washing dishes or sweeping the floor or, you know, even things that going to school becomes a difficult chore. And there's so many ways that they don't succeed in school because they don't have the tools and know how to sit still, discipline themselves, pay attention. They're anxious. All of these things are distracting. So we are not allowing them to actually learn about the real world. You know, before long, they're totally introduced to that secondary world, that virtual world of the imagination. And now it's more invasive and comprehensive and pervasive than it's ever been before. Because in days gone by, you would go to a two-hour movie, then you'd come home and you'd be back in your house, in your room, in your whatever. But now you can spend hours and hours and days in these worlds and not have to come out. And you can just develop that world. I know several years ago, like we were talking earlier, there had the Sims or simulated environments where they could just pretend to be, you know, whatever they want to be. And even in relationships, and because people's worlds are not children, they don't know the real world of God. They can become disappointed, disgruntled, unhappy, and look for, hunger for something that's more real and exciting to them, which virtual worlds are. They're colorful, they're action-packed, they're full of heroic deeds, they're full of, you know, control. They have control of the world when they're in control in the virtual world, they think. But in the real world, they have to submit to everybody else, and they have no power, and they're kind of like victims of their circumstances, whether their people, their parents are poor or whatnot. They don't get to be picked on the team or whatever it is. So they're always subject to disappointment and pain in the real world, whereas in the virtual world, there isn't any, at least in the beginning. The enticement is you're in control. And children are looking for, they're powerless. They're feeling very powerless. And so they're looking for a place and a way to be empowered. And I believe that's what witchcraft does. That's what all of these things we'll be talking about. It empowers them to, you know, to do it themselves, to not have to rely on anybody else, or we can not have to obey anybody else. We can just rebel and do what we want. So that's how I see this as becoming so attractive to both the parents and the child. The parent gets, you know, their parenting duties are reduced tremendously when the child is not, you know, wanting something, asking a question, bugging them for something. And so it's very enticing for the parent as well to just give in, let them play with the game, but let them turn the video game on, whatever. It's just easy. And so that's what we do. We take the easy way.
Yeah. But what do you think about having an imaginary friend? At some point, this concept was really cool with my circle of friends, you know? And like, what this does to a child? Especially if the child is not having other brothers or sisters in the home, or maybe the parents are divorced already, or stuff like that going on already in the family.
Well, that's very old and common. And I believe you're saying something that's very interesting and important. When a child is lonely or alone, or they don't have connections, relationships, which we're all built to want, relationships, love, interaction, those things are not there for them, are not very available. Maybe they are an only child, or maybe their parents are older, or maybe they can't find friends in their neighborhood or whatever. And they don't have real friends, real people to talk to. Then through their imagination, the enemy, really, the devil, seduces them into embracing, creating, we can call them avatars, but in those early days, this was an imaginary friend. And he would sit with you, have tea with you, you could play with them, talk back and forth with them. And really what they were is, you could call them demons or imps. They would come and just attend to the child, watch over the child, and then begin to suggest to the child or feed the child with demonic information and fear. And then the child is no longer has a friend. It has a prison guard or a babysitter, demon or a warden, a prison warden from hell. And they don't realize that. So these are actually, and there's a soul tie that is formed between the child and the imaginary friend. And when Those friends, those imaginary friends, if your child has one, you must break that connection, break that commitment, break that soul tie. If your child is young, still at home, still eating under his feet or under your table and your feet, you have the authority to command that spirit and take the name that the child's name, the spirit, take that name and to identify that demon and deal with it that way. So I command the spirit that impersonates this imaginary friend who's not a friend. I command you in the name of Jesus Christ, let go of my child. I command you with the authority that I have as his parent and as the authority as a believer to leave our home. I take the sword of God's word and I cut you off, separate you from influencing and misleading my child in Jesus' name. It's not a cute little thing. It's not an innocent little thing. It's a very deadly thing that can become very disruptive. And at the end, as this relationship grows and as this spirit gets more and more power over the child, it's like having a demon, but the demon is kind of in your mind, but it's external to you in some ways because you don't see it as yourself. You see it as a friend and as someone outside of yourself. The other way Satan tricks us is by impersonating us to ourselves. So you don't know in those particular instances where you're being lied to by a devil, a demon, and you think it's your thought, you think it's your feeling, and you don't separate yourself from that because you think, well, it came from my mind, it came from my heart, it was in my head. But Satan puts his temptations in our head too. So not every thought you think you thought are thoughts you thought. Some of the thoughts and some of the feelings that we're experiencing are actually the enemy impersonating us to ourselves to get us to simply agree with or accept what's going on. Like, for example, when people say, I am depressed, they're not resisting a spirit of depression. They're actually agreeing with, I'm depressed. So that means depression, the spirit, can come in and lay upon them that spirit of heaviness or despair or whatever. And because they don't separate themselves. Whereas with an imaginary friend, the only difference is the devil is pretending to be a friend outside of you instead of pretending to be you on the inside of you.
Now hearing your explanation about the imaginary friend, I have remembered something I saw on TV a few weeks ago about this going on in this generation of adults, hearing voices, actually. They are hearing voices and they are seeing this as something normal and understanding how amazing the brain is. That now with these cases, we discover that we didn't understood how much our brain can do for us or stuff like that. What do you think about that?
I think that the imaginary friend is an open door to accepting voices, chatting, conversing back and forth with an imaginary friend who's a demonic spirit entity. And those entities also do speak directly into the mind. They don't come necessarily as an imaginary friend. They come to us as a voice, and we recognize it as not our voice. And that freaks us out because it's telling us to do something, sometimes very terrible things. And we feel just terrified because there's something in my house. I don't know what it is, and it's scaring me because it's making me hear these voices and things. And people say that that's normal. Well, it is and it isn't. It is, you know, if you are hearing voices in your head that you know are not you. Now, there's many ways the devil tricks us. He can trick us by pretending to sound like us, or he can pretend to hurt us and frighten us by sounding not like us in our head, or he can be an imaginary friend. And so if you're hearing a voice in your head, the truth is you're hearing a voice in your head. Because a lot of people in the olden days, in the more recent past, people have diagnosed that. They've given them medications for hearing voices. They've named it schizophrenia, paranoid schizophrenic, all these kinds of things. And so people are saying, oh, no, I have a mental illness. Oh, there's something wrong with me. And now I have to have this medication in order to be okay. But the truth is, you're not crazy. It is not a mental illness. It is a spiritual invasion into your head, into your mind. And the devil is able to do things with our mind and brain that we are, you know, not aware of, in creating these conversations and these these challenges. So the devil in your head, this the demon, the spirit, the voice, is prompting you, tormenting you, chattering. So there's no peace. There's no quiet. There's constant anxiety. There's constant distraction. And so there's no revelation of God's peace or of quality of life. So if you have a voice that's going on in your head, you need to, first of all, cancel out your agreement that there's something wrong with you. There's nothing wrong with you. Again, it is a spiritual invasion, and you have an authority and a power through the blood of Jesus Christ, the name of Jesus Christ, the word of God, to command that thing to get out of your house. It's like it's trespassing in your temple. You are like property, temple, property of the Most High God. But just like any property, it can be invaded. It can be, you know, taken over. The enemy can take over some closets in your house. I mean, he can, you know, be in the basement, you know, and you know, you get spooked out by that sometimes. And so, but we need to not be afraid and say, this thing is does not have a right to be there. And any agreement I gave it, I now take back. I cancel out, and I declare that this thing has to leave me. But here's another flip that you're just mentioning. Now science and the world is making it an okay thing. Before, it wasn't an okay thing, like with so many things. Before, it wasn't okay to be, homosexual. It wasn't okay. And now all of a sudden it's wonderfully okay. So you have the world, Satan, giving you this option and then this option. And so all the lines are blurred. We don't know what's really going on. We've lost sight of the truth. And we're just being flipped from pillar to post, like a wave of the sea, driven and tossed, like the Bible says. And so we have to go back to the word of God, which is the anchor. And so if you're hearing a voice in your head, recognize it as something other than you. It's an alien invasion. It doesn't have a right to be there. And you have been given by God the power and authority through Jesus' name to get it out. And if you can't do that all by yourself, because maybe you've lost your ability to even focus and direct that, then you ask someone who knows how to pray to cast this thing, spirit, out of you. Paul says, who will deliver me from this body of death? So there's many things that we need to be delivered. That means they need to be gotten out of us, and that's how we do it. Jesus gave us power to cast out demons. That's what he's talking about. They can be voices in your head. They can be a spirit of fear or anxiety or gluttony or addiction. They can be allurements. They can be lusts and enticements to virtual worlds. They can be all kinds of things. Anything that, because the demons are they're all the same in a way. They're all disembodied. So they need a body, but they all have their own types of personalities and appetites. So if one lusts for power, he is going to lead you into witchcraft. If one lusts towards abuse or perversion or addictions, they're going to set up a different set of cravings inside of you. So the Bible says in Romans chapter 6, verse 12, in the Amplified, it says, Paul says, let not sin rule as king in your mortal, short-lived, perishable body to make you obey it in its lusts, evil passions, and cravings. So the lusts, evil passions, and cravings that are going on in your mind, in your heart, in your body, in your physical body are coming not from you, but from a spirit that has evil passions and cravings and lust. And so you can permit it or you can kick it out because it is your house and you do have the authority to do that. Again, and people get hooked on the drugs, the medications, the Haldol and all those things. And that really warps, twists, changes your whole personality, your outlook on life, your level of energy and hope. It's just very, very destructive to the human body.
Yeah, it's interesting about this documentary I was seeing that they were saying, and still not seeing something wrong here. They came especially to women, not men. And they will come in the person's life who had abuse in their life, like being raped or being abused in their families as children. And also those voices were like all the time telling them that they are bad, they are ugly, they are not smart, all kind of stuff like that. And those people actually started to have conversations with these voices. They will have actual conversations. Mm-hmm. But there's nothing wrong. It's just the brain, you know, discovering our brain.
That's the enemy covering up the lie But, you know, the brain is wonderful and is very capable of doing many things, but it's very easily deceived. It says the mind needs to be transformed and the heart is full of wickedness. And so when we're hearing the accusations, the condemnation, the abuser, it's coming from, I believe, it's really coming from a source of trauma. We never went back there. We never really looked at what happened. We just believed the lies. We tried to cover it over, not go back, not look at it, don't want to hear about it ever again. And yet it still feeds into our life. And so really to get rid of those things, you want to go back to the truth. And the truth is hidden in the trauma, because the trauma is Satan trying to cover up the truth with a lie. And the lie is, I'm guilty, I'm bad, I'm stupid, I'm never going to make it, it's my fault. There's a lot of ways we interact with demons. Another very common way is when people are sleeping and they're asleep at night. You know, many of them are sexually assaulted in the night. They have sexual dreams, nightmares. You know, some of them, you know, even wake up with marks on their bodies and real situations, depending on how active and developed that spiritual force of wickedness is in their life. Some are abducted. I mean, these things are real. And these are real encounters with demonic spirits. But we just say, well, you're just crazy. It's just a mental illness. You know, you know, it's really nothing. It doesn't exist. We kind of lie to the person. And then that makes the person even more upset and more terrified, because maybe there is something wrong with me, which is usually where it settles. And then what do I know? I need to go get help. I need to go to the doctor. I need to go to the psychiatrist. And then you're set up for the rest of your life, basically, to be taken, pounding these pills. And they just make you worse, you lose your life by trying to save your life. And that's what the Bible says. He who seeks to save his life will lose it. Well, if you're, and those who lose their life for my sake, Jesus said, will keep it. So if you feel like your life is being drained away from you, then go back to the Lord and say, the devil, the enemy is stealing my life that you gave me. I'm giving my life to you now. Help me restore this life you've given me, so I'm sane in my mind and I'm purposeful in my life and fruitful in my destiny.
What are the effects of exposing children to witchcraft that we see in movies, in cartoons, and in books or other things?
Well, movies, books, imagery, witchcraft is a very intriguing and powerful, seductive kind of world. There's only two power sources in the world. There's God and the devil. And the devil dresses his power source up to look like you, taking control. It's up to me. You got to take care of myself. So it looks like we're going to take control. We're going to take the power, because God is not doing it. He's not coming through for us. And we're done with waiting and we're impatient and we feel like God doesn't love us and he's not good and he doesn't care. So witchcraft is that solution to instant power through spells, through curses, through empowering. Again, you can go into these lovely worlds that are of the imagination, and they become your favorite world, because in that world, everything does and goes the way you want it to go. And these books, like, for example, Harry Potter back in the day, that was a whole series of books and stories of imagined made-up world that became a real world. A lot of children, back in the day, they wanted to go to visit the Hogwarts School of Witchcraft, thinking it was a real place they could go, a real destination. Then, of course, we built, I'm sure, some sort of a fantasy theme park on Harry Potter somewhere so they could go and visit. But they weren't separating out their schoolroom, you know. And so Harry Potter's got a schoolroom, and it's the same thing. And he's got a magic wand, and I can do all kinds of other things. And I don't have to sit here in this boring class. I can go do fun things like put spells and incantations. And then you've got all of these movies like Twilight. All of these things just keep pummeling and pumping these children full of wrong ideas, and they don't know a truth from a lie after a while. That's the big problem. Even adults, we don't know the truth from the lie after a while. And the lie seems easier for the moment than the truth, because the truth means you're going to have to settle down, confess, repent, be responsible, take action, seek God. And none of that sounds like very much fun. However, can I say this? Just as the devil has a spiritual world that he can invite people into, whether it's through avatars, or imaginary friends, or spells, witchcraft, Hogwarts School of Witchcraft, just as the devil has an imaginary world of the spirit, God has a world of the spirit also. And most Christians do not know about that. They live in a legalistic, gospel of do's and don'ts and mixing law with grace. So they get anxious and confused. They don't know if God's real or not, and he doesn't answer the prayers. But God said, you know what? I'm giving you my spirit. You can walk in that spirit. You can walk in a place where you can have spiritual power. You know, it's actually like words of knowledge, words of wisdom, miracles, faith and healings, and, you know, even speaking in tongues. You can have God's power in God's spiritual world if you're walking in the spirit. But that means a lot of things. Simply, the simplest thing it means is that you're going to have to let go of doing things your way and yield to God and allow his spirit to live in you. And that what that means is when a Christian becomes born again, they actually are also agreeing that they've died. And once we've died, we've been crucified with Christ, it is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me, and the life I now live, I live by the faith of the Son of God. And so then his spirit comes in, and in him, the spirit, I live and move and have my being. And then it means to live as Christ. So it's a whole different spirit. It's a world of a spiritual world on the other side. So whatever Satan has got over here offering his enticements and seductions and spells on this, and you can put curses on people. In this other world of God, you can put blessings on people. You can bring forth miracles. You can heal dead, sick bodies. You can raise the dead. All these things are also available in God's spiritual world.
Yeah, it's interesting that you would see Christians that would think speaking in other tongues is weird, but they will allow their children to watch cartoons that will have actual spells in them, like actual incantations and all that, and there's nothing wrong with it. You know, like, for weird.
We've been desensitized. We have accepted all of these things, spells, incantations, violence. We've accepted them as real. And like going back to this idea of this is now a thing, you know, the virtual world and living in it with the goggles and whatnot, so people can actually become a member of an oasis, a team. There's war and conflict in their oasis, and this is all fake. There's nothing real to it, but it becomes your reality. It becomes a false reality. And so people, again, are being drawn into this because they have no power. They're sitting in a bleak natural world where Satan is taking away more and more any hope of owning a home or any hope of making a good wage or any hope of having a healthy family or any hope of any of those things is just being crushed by the God of this world who's trying to destroy our natural God-given desires to accomplish things, to live, to you know, we've all been given talents. Something, you know, maybe you're a talented singer or actress, or maybe you have the abilities to do numbers, you know, but nothing of that. All those gifts are being spilt and wasted because we're going into another world where they're consuming. Satan is just entertaining you until you are at the place where he can kill you. You're just in the loading docks of hell in those virtual worlds, and you don't want to come out because it's so nice in here. It's, you know, you're being led into the gas chamber and you look like you're going to finally get a shower and they're going to be nice to you. But while they're giving you the shower in the gas chamber, they're turning on the gas and you're dying. And, you know, you don't leave because in the process of some types of death, like asphyxiation, you don't leave because you don't even know you need to leave. You're just being killed slowly. And that's what these virtual worlds are.
What do you think about the violence we see in video games, especially? Like sometimes you will have the kids or teenagers just watching the violence. Other times they will be the one being aggressed, or they will be the people who aggress others. What that does after a long time spending with video games?
Well, you lose your identity. Mm-hmm. You don't know who you are anymore, and that violence becomes a part. That is a spirit that takes over your abilities and, you know, wants to revenge and shed blood and whatnot. In the olden days, you'd see the kids sit there playing the game and they'd be punching their little joysticks or whatever they were doing. And they were making the action figures do the acting. Now it's different. Now they're in their own video game being the actor, being the hero, the perpetrator, the warrior, whatever. And so it's different. It's a grade up or a grade down. Every step Satan is taking us is closer and closer to our own destruction. So before you were just playing it, first you're watching it, then you're playing it, and now you become it. And so that's where you get the avatar thing and all that. And everything in this world is pushing towards that wicked end. And very few people and very few Christians even see it as deadly. They're so mesmerized, seduced, deceived, distracted themselves that they don't realize their children are being stolen from them. And this is one of the curses in Deuteronomy 28, that your children will be taken from you by foreigners. Well, these foreigners are aliens, you know, virtual realities and lying technology. It's all very wicked. And after a while, when you get into technology, the parts become so small, the transmissions become so quick. There's no more wires. There's just whatever. There's electricity and signals. And pretty soon it's like, how can this even work anymore? This doesn't work on the principles of gravity or electronics or feedback. This works on a spiritual dimension. So technology is actually being empowered as we go deeper into it by demonic spirits. The God of the prince of the power of the air, that's one of the names of one of the gods, the prince of the power of the air, is who's taken over that element of our world and environment, the technology, the airwaves, the microwaves, the radio waves, the visual images. And another thing is when you look at things, they become burned in your brain. Those images in the movie theater, those violent images, and they become burned in your brain, and then you see them later in a dream. You're terrified by them. Satan can pull them up anytime he wants to because they're burned in your brain. And the only way you get rid of those is by pleading the blood of Jesus over them and, you know, confessing that this was a bad thing to do. So really the only key here for hope is to return to the truth of Jesus Christ. What does he say? Several things Jesus says. When he comes back, he says, will the Son of Man really find faith on the earth? And then he also says he has to quicken or cause his time to come more quickly because lest there be no one left, there's no flesh left alive. So where he's got to come to rescue his own creation from the insidious and amazingly demonically contrived intelligences of Satan, who only has one thing in mind, and that is to get even with God in his supreme hatred and contempt for God by destroying God's creation. Yeah. But we have Jesus Christ, and Jesus Christ is a formidable enemy, and he is the king. He is the one who defeated the devil at the cross on that day of resurrection. Ultimately, everything was done and settled at that point, but we're still walking it out, talking it out. You know, God's still sending the Holy Spirit. People are still being born. And so the whole victory has already been established, but if Satan can continue to deceive people into believing it's not done yet and I can do what I want and we can choose who we're going to serve and who's going to win this war, he can just prolong this thing until Jesus Christ says, that's enough, I'm back, done. And that's but what's going to have to happen. The Lord's just going to have to cut this thing off at some point. So does that make sense?
Yeah.
Yes.
It's kind of sobering, I know, but nonetheless, bless you guys for what you're doing. And, you know, God has raised you up to do it. And so I pray that people who are watching will be brought into the fullness of that revelation. They Amen. Won't stay in the darkness. Amen.
Well, my next question is, how real is the virtual world those young people are living in and the kids are living in? So they are spending hours there with these activities, and how real becomes after you spend 2, 3, 4 hours a day. You know, for example, was a case a few months ago about a lady that she was going in metaverse. Mm-hmm. It's something created by Facebook. By Facebook, you go there, you can pick how you look and what mm-hmm, you do yeah. there, what activities to have, you know. But this lady was a lady in her 40s. Soon after she came in the game, or whatever that is, she was raped, abused by 3 men or something like that. So she addressed this as a trauma in her life. I mean, how real is actually this world and how dangerous can be to our real life or for our kids, basically? Because this lady was old enough, but you can have a kid in this situation.
And you can have a child, you can have an adult. And, you know, this is a real world. The virtual world, the virtual reality is a reality. It's another dimension. It has different dimensions. I think our real world has like four dimensions, time, space, you know, volume, whatever. But in the virtual world, there are other dimensions, spiritual encounters, demonic entrances, visitation, demons. And so the fact that she was raped and felt violated and traumatized, that is a real thing. So whatever happened in that spiritual world was being experienced in her real world, in her normal world. And so this just shows you, this is proof that these things are real. And that, and again, like it's similar to, you know, in your real world, you can be sleeping in the sleeping part of your real world and be sexually assaulted in the night by a demon as well. So there are ways these enemies enter into our world and or entice us to go into their world. I believe the virtual world is a spiritual world of darkness, and they entice us to come in there. And children are, you know, again, many reasons why people go through that door to use that as an escape. But, you know, it is a real world. And the fact that now we're proving people have traumas, people have pain, actually, they go into these worlds to escape pain. And now they're seeing that that's not working because it's actually creating pain and torment. And of course, if you're sitting all day long playing a virtual game, virtual reality, have an avatar, you're not going to get up and get your food. You're not going to eat right. You're not going to go out and get a job. You're not going to sweep your house. You're not going to be able to survive very long in the real world. Unless you have someone taking care of you and you have all your free time to just, you know, indulge in that other world. So it's all designed to destroy us. And, you know, that's God knew this in the beginning. God knew all about this. We're not ahead of God. God is not caught off guard with any of this. And so his plan is always the same, to deliver us from this present evil world. So, yeah, it can be real. It is real.
Could you give an advice to counselors or leaders in church who maybe have this kind of teenagers or kids coming to them, telling them that they experienced this? What's your advice for those leaders?
You know, most counselors will not bring forth a spiritual reality or a spiritual dimension or the fact that there's a real devil or really demons and there's a war going on between God and Satan. They will avoid that at all costs. Even Christian counselors don't want to rock the boat or bring in these things because, as you said earlier, people see that as weird. But it's not weird. It's real. And until you have the real rules of the game, you're not going to be able to play the game and win. It's not a game. It's life or death, actually. But so if you are willing to tell the child the truth will set them free. And I think children are much more able to hear about this spiritual war because of their exposure to the video games and the violence and things. So to them, that already is a spiritual world. And so if you just pull it back into the natural world is at war as well with an entity. Not just, you know, go to war across the world in some other country, but we're actually at war with a spiritual being or a force, powers. This is in Ephesians, it says, we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against powers and principalities and spiritual wickedness in high places. These things are real and they are there. And we need to know that we do have weapons to fight against them. But if the counselors are just going to give them the pat answers, the scientific answers, well, it's really nothing. And here's a med. Take this medication, you'll be fine. Then we're just feeding into the problem, really.
Actually, this virtual world, it's like an imitation of the spiritual world. Mm-hmm. We're supposed to live every day in a spiritual world. And actually to believe in God, in miracles, in transforming us every day. Something that you could see also in games.
Right, right. See, so whatever God has, Satan has a counterfeit for it, a substitute for it. And so the spiritual world that God gave us to live in the place of power, miracles, you know, raising people from the dead, healing the sick, cleansing the lepers, all of those kinds of things, preaching the gospel. Satan has offered the same thing in his world. But it's not a real world. It's all fake. It's all imaginary. It's all pretend. It's all not real. It's all when you come out of that, take those goggles off, you're still in that other world, the real world, where you're going to have to give an account to God someday for what you've done in the real world, or when you hung out in the virtual world. You're going to still have to give an account to the real God who put you, created you in his world. I think the crisis is upon us, and people escape. They don't want to be there. And then there's no one who really knows how to help them get out of it for the most part. So the Lord's going to have to intervene. But you're right. There is a, God is the real spiritual world. And most believers, like I said earlier, do not even live in that spiritual reality. They live in a legalistic, performance-based, behavior-based gospel that is not the gospel of grace and good news. It's a gospel of good works. Even though we say, yes, yes, Jesus died on the cross, and that's how we get to heaven, we're still working to get to heaven. We seem to not have been able to disconnect from that idea that we have to be good to get to heaven. No, we don't have to be good to get to heaven. We are good, and we need to behave according to who we are, which means I don't really want to drink. I don't really want to kill anybody. Why would I want to live in a virtual world when I can live in the real world and in the spiritual world that God has allowed me to live in and have a real relationship with the one true God as my Father? But people have lost interest in, just like in the Old Testament, they lost interest in the God who got them through the Red Sea, the God who appeared on the mountain and gave them the Ten Commandments, you know, the God who pulled water out of the rock. They lost interest in that God, and they went murmuring, complaining, and whoring after the pagans that were all around them. And this is the same thing. We're just whoring after what the pagans have. We want what they have. The heathens, those who don't love God, know God. And now the believers are being even seduced and sucked into the same disobedience and rebellion because they refuse the love of the truth. And when people, 2 Thessalonians 2:10 says, if we refuse the love of the truth, God comes to give you the truth, you reject it over and over, then it says, then God will send a strong delusion that we believe a lie. So, okay, you don't want to believe the truth, then okay, you want to believe this other thing, okay, I got to let you go because that's what you want. And you get to choose because you have a free will. And so people choose to do what they want to do because God is allowing them to operate in their free will. And then things go wrong. And then they get mad at God because God wasn't there when their world fell apart. But their world fell apart because they didn't listen to him in the first place. And so now they're blaming God for what they chose to do, which was cooperate with, follow after the enemy, do what he says. And so now they're in trouble. Well, you can come back to God. You can repent. You can confess your sin. God is not mad at you. He knew you were going to do it. Come back to him. The Bible says, confess your sins. If you will confess your sin, he's faithful and just to forgive your sins and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. A lot of this that needs to happen is people need to be delivered, get these ugly, horrible operating systems of death out of them and have a true heart, a pure heart, a holy heart and mind and body and will and life towards God, which is only done through the Holy Spirit, who sanctifies us and leads us into all truth. So you have to live in that Holy Spirit world in order to get that experience of the holiness of God and the love of God and the peace of God and the power and the truth that sets us free.
Amen. Well, it's interesting that when I was telling you about this topic I would like to discuss, you said when we'll go to God, he will judge us for what we did as avatars. Well, that's something we should think about it, maybe, as Christians, if we like to spend our time there. If that's our real world now, that's interesting.
The avatar is you are giving an entity, a spirit, permission to use your identity because you think it's you. You're thinking, okay, I'm going to be this avatar now. I'm going to do all these things and have a wonderful life and control my life and do it the way I want. But you're actually giving your life, your real life, the life God gave you, you're giving it over to an avatar. You're projecting your life, your identity, your hopes, your dreams, your energy, your everything onto that demonic entity. So now he gets to run your life and you still think it's you, but wait for a while and you'll find out that he's going to betray you. He's going to turn on you and he's going to kill you. So yes, I believe we're going to have to give an account to God for everything that we did or chose unless we've been forgiven. And then it's, then God doesn't remember it anymore. So that's the good news about the mercy and grace of God. God is not here to see us fail. He's not here to kill us. He is here to redeem us out of a snake pit. And he knows how treacherous the snake pit is. He knows how treacherous the snakes are, how wily the devil is. He knows that. So he doesn't really expect us to figure it out. He didn't say figure it out. He said, follow me, and I will perfect that which concerns you. So there are some, there's a remnant, and they're growing. There's a growing remnant of young people, I believe, as well as older people who are following, finding the truth and taking up the sword of God's word and truth and walking in the power of his spirit. Mm-hmm. God is not going to be defeated in all this. He will have a harvest.
Yeah.
In Jesus' name.
And one of the reasons we did this series and this episode is for people to get the revival, the real gospel, and understanding how Satan comes to deceive this generation and not just go with the flow, you know, with the culture. And maybe it will be a good idea to finish with a prayer. Maybe some young people would like to repent. They spend so much time in this and now they understand there was something demonic in this, maybe. I don't know.
Yes,
whatever the Spirit of the Lord leads you to pray.
Yes, amen. Well, Father God, we thank you for the revelation of Jesus Christ, your love, for dying on the cross for us, standing in our place, becoming the sacrifice for us. When we were slated to die, scheduled to die, you stood in our place and you took the death sentence for us. And then you rose from the dead. You defeated Satan for our purpose, for our sake. And then you sent the Holy Spirit to live inside of us so that we can be led and guided by the truth. Not by some avatar. So, Lord God, if we have been deceived, if anyone here listening has been deceived, tricked, which is obviously a trick, they were deceived, misled, Father, that they will recognize that the spirit, an entity that misled them, is not the Holy Spirit, and they don't have to follow it anymore. So simply give them courage, Father, to repent, identify what they believed to be the lie, confess it as a lie, forgive themselves for believing the lie, and forgive anyone else who misled them, and that you, Father God, would judge their enemy, who is the spirit of death and destruction and virtual reality, and the ones, the prince, the power of the air, the virtual realities, the enticements, the witchcraft, all of that that misled them, Father, that you would judge these enemies now according to the testimony of Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, who saw everything that was going on to mislead this precious soul. And I pray that they will be delivered even now as they hear, as we pray, from these spirits immediately, Father, immediately, that there won't be a process or won't be a stranger struggle or whatever. There will be a cutting of the sword of your word and truth, but cut those spirits, entities, cords, binding, soul ties from them. Those agreements will be dissolved by the blood of Jesus Christ, and a new agreement will be made with the grace and the goodness and the love and trust in Jesus Christ. And Father, we ask these things to be done and accomplished through your Spirit for Jesus' sake and in Jesus' name. Amen.
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 Thank you.
Yes, thank you for allowing me to enjoy this time with you and to pray the blessing, a blessing upon all those who listen, who watch, who view, who turn to this and learn from this, that God will truly bless them in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Thank you for being with us. Until next time, God bless you.